Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Gunner and the Grunt. Two Boston boys in Vietnam with the 1st Cavalry Division Airmobile. By Michael L. Kelley and Peter Burbank. Narrated by Malcolm Hillgartner. Soldier. I was that which others did not want to be. I went where others feared to go, and did what others failed to do. I asked nothing from those who gave nothing, and reluctantly accepted the thought of eternal loneliness, should I fail. I have seen the face of terror, felt the stinging cold of fear, and enjoyed the sweet taste of a moment's love. I have cried, pained, and hoped, but most of all, I have lived times others would say were best forgotten. At least someday, I will be able to say that I was proud of what I was. A soldier. Written by George L. Skypeck, combat veteran, Captain, U.S. Army. Copyright Captain George L. Skypeck. You can never have too much reconnaissance. General George S. Patton, 3rd Army, World War II. If you're going through hell, keep going. Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill, World War II. Prologue. The Lost Gunship. December 12, 1965. Kelley, from now on, don't carry your wallet when you go out on recon missions. The weapons platoon sergeant smiled and put his hand on my shoulder. Why? We lost a gunship last month in the Yadrang Valley. If you get shot down like they did, we don't want the enemy to get their hands on your personal stuff. Understand? I understand. His words filled me with fear. Later that evening, the door gunners and crew chiefs returned to the tent and began to unwind from a long day of flying combat assault missions in support of the infantry brigade battalions. I was a new man, a cherry still pissing stateside water. They sat on their cots, smoking cigarettes and playing cards under the single 60-watt bulb hanging from the center tent pole. I watched and listened, trying my best to learn about who these guys were and where I fit in. So far, it seemed like I didn't. To make things worse, I was much younger than they were. Most had been in the army a couple of years or longer. They ignored me as they joked and talked about some of the missions they had flown in past battles, especially the recent campaign in the Yadrang Valley. These men were hardened combat veterans who had seen much death and destruction. I was afraid to talk to them, but my curiosity about the lost gunship overcame my fear. I wanted to know more about this ghost story that was haunting me. Surely I could ask someone. Specialist 4 Bill Clark was sitting on his cot with a cigarette hanging off his lips, sharpening his bayonet with a special stone. Something about his manner made him seem more approachable. Maybe it was because he was alone. Could you tell me about the gunship that got lost in Yadrang last month? Sure, kid, I'll tell you about the lost gunship. He pulled a drag from his cigarette and eyed me with amusement. One of our air crews were out screening the flanks of the 3rd Brigade somewhere in the vast Yadrang Valley when they came across some enemy and took them under fire. The North Vietnamese troops shot their Huey gunship down with automatic weapons fire. All 4 crewmen were killed. He looked away and continued to make his bayonet razor sharp. Clark was a man of few words, and his story was brief and lacking in detail. I went back to my cot feeling immensely dissatisfied and wondering what the fate of those 4 crewmen had been. I did not learn the full story until many years later, while attending one of my unit's reunions. I was talking with some of my old pilots, Dick Marshall and Johnny Gower. Both Marshall and Gower were retired Army officers with long careers flying helicopters, and if anyone knew the story of the lost gunship, it would be these 2 pilots. They were there when it went down. On November 16, 1965, about 3 weeks before I arrived in country at Anke Base Camp, Troop C was flying out of the Duck Co Special Forces camp north of the Adrang, attached to the 3rd Brigade, 1st Cavalry Division, Airmobile, which was engaged in deadly ground combat with the North Vietnamese Army's, NVA, B-3 Front Division, near the Chupong Mountain in the valley. This was the very first major battle of the Vietnam War. Marshall was flying one of two Huey gunships on a screening and recon support mission to make sure the enemy did not outflank the brigade's infantry. With him were two Little Birds, OH-13S Sioux Aero Scout recon helicopters, flying low level just above the treetops, looking for signs of the enemy. Gower was a pilot on one of the Little Birds. The other gunship with Marshall was his chase ship, piloted by warrant officers Billy J. Talley and Benedicto P. Bayron, door gunners Sergeant James L. Riley and Specialist 5 Billy M. Knight were also on board. Talley called Marshall on the radio and told him they were low on fuel and were going to return to Duck Co. to refuel. Somewhere along their flight path back to Duck Co., while at treetop level, they encountered NVA forces under the jungle canopy. They sent a radio message to the command post, CP, at Duck Co., that they were going to engage the enemy. That was the last radio contact the troop had with the gunship. Talley's door gunners fired their M60 door guns briefly before the NVA managed to shoot the gunship down in the fast-running firefight. I always believed the pilots were hit by automatic weapons fire, which made them lose control of their ship and crash. I wondered how many times Marshall had thought of those moments in the years since returning home. Eventually, Marshall's gunship and the two scout birds returned to Duck Cove for fuel and ammo, before quickly flying back to the battlefield to conduct a search for their lost crewmen. They tried to make radio contact with Warrant Officer Talley, but there was no response from the gunship. Scout pilot Captain Johnny Gower and his scout observer gunner were flying low and slow over the jungle in a grid fashion over the general area where it was estimated the gunship went down. Eventually, Gower and his scout observer spotted the wreckage of the gunship in a small jungle clearing laying on its side. Gower pulled up his radio. "I found it. The Huey looks like it made a hard landing and rolled over. I'm going to try to land and make a ground search for the crewmen." The trees were high and thickly forested, but Gower was a very experienced and skillful aviator. He managed to find an open spot and lowered his Little Bird down to the jungle floor. He kept his engine on and his rotors turning in case he needed to make a quick escape in the event of an enemy attack. He was deep inside NVA territory, a place the troops called Indian Country. "Make a search to the west side of the wreckage for any signs of the crewmen," Gower told his scout observer as he looked at the Huey and noticed that the machine guns were still mounted on the aircraft. He then began to search towards the east of the ship. At the edge of a clearing, he saw one of the pilots sitting up against a tree. The pilot had been shot in the head by the NVA and was bleeding all over, having sustained various injuries in the crash. The scout observer spotted the other pilot in the same condition. They did not find the two door gunners. Above them, circling overhead, was Marshall's gunship and the other OH-13S scout, Little Bird, keeping a sharp eye out for enemy movement. Captain James Kidd, Marshall's co-pilot, spotted NVA troops on a nearby hill. He called down to Gower on the radio to warn them, but Gower and his scout observer did not hear the call because they were outside their aircraft looking around. "All of a sudden, I began to get a spooky feeling that I was being watched." Gower shivered as he remembered the feeling that was still so vivid to him even years later. Gower yelled at his observer to get back into the helicopter, and just as he started to do the same, the NVA began to fire in his direction from the jungle. Gower jumped into his Little Bird and quickly powered up the 260-horsepower Lycoming engine for takeoff. Just then he heard Captain Kidd on the radio. "Thirsty White, this is Thirsty Red. Get out of there now. Enemy, on your left flank." "Roger that, Red." Of course, Gower already knew the enemy was near, as he had received their calling card, a burst of automatic weapons fire. He rolled the throttle control and brought his Little Bird up to full maximum power, and then pulled up on the collective control for a straight vertical takeoff. This was the most stressful kind of takeoff for any helicopter, especially in a tropical environment where even a normal takeoff can be dangerous. As the NVA closed in for the kill, the little Sioux warrior climbed up through the jungle canopy. As Gower cleared the treetops, he swung his bird around and lowered the nose, firing a long burst from his twin M60C 7.62mm outboard machine guns at the enemy. That suppressive fire was just enough for him to make his getaway. The little bird sprang forward and took off like an African gazelle. Marshall had his door gunners open up on the enemy below to keep them at bay. Gower called back to the CP at Duck Co. and gave them the estimated position of the downed Huey, while Troop Commander Major Billy Williams called in an Air Force airstrike to drop napalm onto the lost Huey gunship in order to destroy it. A few weeks later, an Aero rifle platoon from Troop B located the remains of the dead gunship crewmen and brought them back to the base camp. Rumors spread all over the 1st Cavalry Division that the gunship crewmen had been mutilated and tortured by the enemy. Those kinds of stories only made crewmen like me very nervous and scared. In reality, the bodies had probably been attacked by the many wild jungle animals, insects, and other creepy things on the jungle floor, causing them to appear as though they had been mutilated. The facts of this story were related to me by these two very brave pilots. I will never forget them, or the memories of the fear I carried with me during my tour of duty in Vietnam as an Army helicopter crewman. The following information concerns the four gunship crewmen killed in action in the Yadrang Valley on November 16, 1965, while supporting the ground forces of the 3rd Brigade, 1st Cavalry Division, Airmobile. Warrant Officer 1, Billy J. Talley, age 27, born May 31, 1938, hometown McCrory, Arkansas, 8-year service. Vietnam Wall Panel 03E, Line 67. Buried at Military Cemetery, Fort Lewis, Washington. Warrant Officer 1, Benedicto P. Bayron, age 31, born June 3, 1934, hometown, Waianae, Hawaii. 12-year service, Vietnam Wall Panel 03E, Line 64. Sergeant James L. Riley, age 30, born May 8, 1935, hometown, Vienna, West Virginia. 12-year service, Vietnam Wall Panel 03E, Line 67. SP-5 Billy M. Knight, age 28, born September 18, 1937, hometown, Ganado, Arizona. 10-year service, Vietnam Wall Panel 03E, Line 66. Chapter 1. High School Warriors. Mike. I didn't know it when I woke up that morning, but my life would change drastically on August 17, 1964. Like many American teenagers, I had always wanted to be a soldier or a Marine. After all, we were raised on a diet of John Wayne war movies and Hershey bars back then, basic elements of soldiers at war. War, however, was not on my mind when I enlisted into the United States Army. I knew nothing about Vietnam. It wasn't the big story in 1964. I did not know that Americans were risking their lives in that faraway jungle nation. All I knew about the Army was what my older brother George told me about his service in Germany and the weekend visits from my history teacher, Mr. Healy, who was a sergeant in the Army National Guard. Healy was a tall, lanky ex-Marine with a crew cut who had come through our city neighborhood on the weekends in an Army Jeep with a couple of big National Guardsmen. They were looking for some of our neighborhood friends who had skipped out of their weekend duty with the 101st Infantry Regiment. We used to call them high school warriors because many of them were juniors and seniors at our school, Ringe Technical High School in Cambridge, Massachusetts, just a few city blocks from the world-famous Harvard University. The scene was almost always the same. Mr. Healy would pull up to our street corner and ask us if we had seen his men. Of course, we told him we hadn't, and of course, he knew we were lying. Frustrated, he would speed away to continue searching all the side streets and the local ballpark for his high school warriors. We knew his search would be fruitless. The high school warriors had come by earlier with a hot rod Ford, hauling a small motorboat and fishing gear. They were heading down to the Charles River to enjoy the warm afternoon on the water, fishing and drinking cold beers. On Monday in history class, Mr. Healy always asked me if I'd seen his men, and again I said no. As far as I knew, he never caught any of his missing men. After graduation in June of 1964, I was working as a stock boy in a Boston factory for $1.25 an hour. When the opportunity to enlist in the Army National Guard presented itself, I decided that it was for me. How hard could it be? The boys could always go fishing when they wanted to, and they still got paid by the National Guard. And besides, they give you a cool-looking military uniform, and they wear those flat-topped Fidel Castro hats. I wanted one of those Castro hats, so I asked my good friend Henry to join up with me on the buddy plan. Back then, almost half of our city neighborhood guys were in the National Guard. Before Vietnam, it was kind of a local tradition for a guy to sign up to be with his friends when he turned 17. We didn't see it as avoiding the draft. That wasn't even really a thing yet. Uncles, cousins, school buddies, and neighbors became weekend riflemen, cooks, and truck drivers. And some became ghosts, like Mr. Healy's missing men. On a typical weekend, about 10 guys would be waiting on the corner of Hurley Street for the Army Guard M211 deuce-and-a-half cargo trucks to pick them up. Back then, many guys did not own cars, so the guard sent out trucks to pick them up. The men loaded up on the back of the trucks, and their women would give them a sweet send-off. I still remember how the big trucks would belch black smoke as they pulled up the street to the cheers of their womenfolk. In the summer, the send-off was an extra special treat to witness as the guardsmen deployed for their annual 2 weeks of training up in the woods of Camp Drum, New York. The sound of the trucks, the sight of their women kissing and hugging them, and the way they looked in their uniforms was enough to recruit any young red-blooded neighborhood kid. We thought that the guard was a good deal. It was a hot and humid August morning when I got ready to go see the National Guard recruiter. As I was leaving the house, my brother George intercepted me. "Where are you going?" "I'm on my way to join the guard with Henry," I puffed up proudly, and then turned to leave again. George looked at me in disbelief. "Are you crazy? The guard is a waste of time. If you are going to join up, you should go into the regular army, not the National Guard." "Why?" "You won't see Germany and meet beautiful women and drink good German beer in the National Guard, that's why." After a few minutes listening to his accounts of his recent army duty in West Germany, I began to give this regular army thing some thought. Traveling to a foreign country to meet beautiful women and drink good beer was very appealing. I got on the phone and called Henry to ask him if he would join the army with me. "What? I'll go into the National Guard with you, but forget that army stuff. 3 years is too long for me." Then he hung up. On August 13, 1964, I took the Green Line train from Leechmere Station in East Cambridge to downtown Boston to see the Army recruiter. After taking all the aptitude tests, I signed up for the aircraft repair technician course. To qualify for the course, I had to leave within 3 days to start basic training. On August 17th, I said goodbye to my family and went to the Armed Forces Induction Center at the Boston Army Base on Summer Street. There I raised my right hand and was sworn into the United States Army. The fun, travels, and adventures were about to begin. My only regret was that I would never receive one of those cool-looking Castro hats like Mr. Healy wore. Chapter 2. Basic Combat Training. Mike. The humid midnight air of Columbia, South Carolina was filled with the smell of barbecue chicken and diesel exhaust. The heat was oppressive for this Yankee boy. I had never been outside of Boston before, and the land of Dixie was a strange new world to me. I was only 18 and dumber than a block of wood. I had no idea what life was like in other parts of the country. I wasn't prepared at all for the scenes of stark poverty that I would see on the bus ride from the airport. Miles of country roads were lined with shanty homes between the fields of crops, housing poor people, white and black, living on the fringes of destitution. It was a real eye-opener for a young boy from the city. Back then, the civil rights movement was just taking root in the South, but I would soon find myself right in the middle of it. Our passenger bus, loaded with new recruits from the Fort Jackson Basic Training Center, sat in the parking lot of a run-down 1950s bus depot out in the Carolina countryside. Bright yellow neon lights glowed in the darkness, reflecting off the side windows of the bus as we looked out to see a surreal scene of elderly black couples, middle-aged white farmers, and teenage mothers with small children walking in and out of a small cafeteria. When we got off the bus and went inside for a cold soda, we stood around taking in the sights of all these night travelers eating hot corn dogs and drinking Dr. Pepper colas. We weren't expecting the separate restrooms for travelers. There were restrooms for Negroes only and restrooms for whites only. Back in Boston, we all used the same restrooms. This was our first introduction to the Deep South. The bus drivers mingled in front of the dispatch office, chain-smoking cigarettes and drinking cups of coffee to keep them awake for the long drive ahead. After a 15-minute stay, we loaded back onto our bus and settled in for the next adventure. For most of us new recruits, encountering the bus depot and the sights and strange new smells from down in the land of Dixie was a powerful experience that we would always remember. As our bus pulled out of the depot, we found ourselves wondering what our next experience would be, somewhere out in that dark southern night. Our military escort was supposed to have met us at the Columbia Airport when our plane landed from Boston, but he was a no-show. Lucky for us, the driver was waiting outside the airport terminal to pick us up. As we left the bus depot, our driver advised us that we would be going downtown to pick up the sergeant. A few minutes down the highway, we reached the outskirts of downtown Columbia and rolled to a stop in front of a honky-tonk bar. The driver parked the bus and went inside to find our escort. Those of us who were still awake peered out the windows to watch the action. The streets were empty, with patches of dim light dotting the sidewalks. The bar was alive, and the sound of country music flowed from its open door. The sight of dancing bodies framed the doorway. After a few minutes, a driver came out of the swirling smoke and sounds, arm in arm with a soldier. They slowly stumbled up the stairs of the bus, and the soldier fell into a front seat. He turned and looked at us with glassy eyes. Then he began to curse and shout at us.
"Listen up, you bunch of maggots. I'm Sergeant Lester, and I'm in charge here. You got that?"
"Yes, sir."
His glare made it immediately obvious that our response had been unacceptable to him. A hush settled upon the rows of sleepy-eyed young men. The sergeant threw out some more curses while the driver put the bus in gear and drove off towards the army post. As the bus rolled down the road, Sergeant Lester stood up, swaying back and forth with the movement of the bus, his drunken legs just barely supporting his weight.
"What the hell kind of answer is that? I want to hear you people. Do you understand?"
This time we gave the man what he wanted, a loud yell that reverberated through the bus.
"Yes, sir."
"That's better."
A brief smile passed over his lips.
"But from now on, you don't call Sergeant Sir. I ain't no officer. You got that?"
"Yes, Sergeant."
Sergeant Lester dropped back into his seat, lit up a cigarette, and began to give the driver directions to the army post. As they argued over the correct road to take, we were glad to be out from under his attention, even if it was for just a few moments. We sat in our seats wondering what our fate would be. Some of us were deep in thought, others were deep in sleep. We would soon discover that sleep and deep thought would be in limited supply during our basic training. Sergeant Lester would be the first in a long line of Army NCOs who would be on our backs for the next 8 weeks as we converted from soft, undisciplined civilians into a platoon of motivated soldiers. After riding for about a half hour, we arrived at the reception station at Fort Jackson. The sergeant staggered off the bus and stood by the open door. He pulled out a piece of paper from his jacket and tried to read off our names as we filed out of the bus, but it was too dark, and he was too drunk to read the list. He eventually gave up and snapped at us to hurry up. We scurried down the narrow aisle and out the door. He made us form up into two columns and began to give us a little lecture.
"You men are in for it. If you expect to make it out of here, you better keep your mouths shut and your heads out of your asses. I don't care if you were a football jock or a city punk. You don't know what it means to be tough. In the next few weeks, you're going to find out what tough really means. Now get down on your bellies and give me 20 push-ups.
He was still drunk, but his bark was loud. We fell to the ground and slowly began to go through the motions of doing push-ups. As we grunted and strained, he got back on the bus and shouted from the doorway as it roared out of the parking lot, "Stay right where you are and keep them push-ups going. Someone will be here to get you." As the smell and dust of the bus exhaust blew in our faces, and we watched the taillights disappear into the darkness, our push-ups came to an abrupt stop. Suddenly it was dead quiet. We lingered around, wondering what was going to happen next. 2 a.m. turned to 3 a.m., and it began to get chilly and damp. Off to one side of the lot was a street light and a one-story wood building with a wide staircase. We decided to go over and sit on the stairs while awaiting our fate. By now we were exhausted from our long ordeal, and we huddled together trying to keep warm. We waited and waited, but no one came to meet us. At some point, lights began to come on in the buildings along the road, and soon we heard noise. In the distance we could hear, but not see, men yelling and heavy footsteps. The sound grew louder and closer with each passing moment. Soon they were upon us, hundreds of men in white t-shirts running along the dark streets, shouting in cadence while their boots hit the pavement in a steady, beating rhythm. Although mesmerized by the bass coming to life, we were tired and hungry, not having slept or eaten since the previous day. As the sun came up over a hazy horizon, we were still waiting. Finally, round about 6 a.m., a lone soldier walked up to us and instructed us to pick up our bags and follow him. He took us to a mess hall for breakfast and hot coffee, and then we were marched to a row of administrative buildings where we were processed in. From there, he led us to a barber shop where they cut off our hair. Next came a big warehouse where we lined up for uniform issue. After receiving a duffel bag filled with fresh new army clothes, we were taken to a row of old World War II wooden barracks and assigned a bunk bed and a wall locker. For the remainder of the day, we were told to clean up the barracks for inspection. After sweeping and washing the floors and the bathroom, which was called a latrine, we stood by our bunks waiting for a sergeant to inspect our work. But when he entered our barracks, he did not bother to inspect anything. Instead, he called out our names and told us we would be pulling a thing called fire watch during the night. Fire watch consisted of a one-hour duty where we had to walk around outside the barracks with a red helmet liner and a flashlight and keep an eye out for fire in and around the barracks. After the evening meal, we waited sleepily in our barracks to start our assigned duty. My watch was from 1 a.m. to 2 a.m. As I sat on my bunk waiting to serve my time, I reflected on the events of the past 30 or so hours and concluded that the Army was a nightmare. I couldn't believe that I had enlisted for 3 years. Once I pulled my duty of fire watch, I climbed into my bunk and immediately fell into a deep sleep. The few hours of sleep I got was a luxury, and by the next morning at 04:30 hours Army time, the manic routine continued. Each day at the reception station was worse than the day before. Sergeants constantly yelled at us, making us do endless push-ups when we were too slow, and regular details called police call, picking up trash and cigarettes. Finally, on the third day, a sergeant came with news of relief. "Men, you will soon be leaving this area for your training companies. This place will be behind you as you move on to Tank Hill, where life won't be so bad anymore." Knowing that we would soon be leaving the reception station that we called the Hell Hole was some comfort to us. While waiting for the trucks that would transport us to arrive, we wondered what this place called Tank Hill was. By mid-afternoon, we were on our way. The Army cargo trucks carried us past rows and rows of white wooden barracks up a steep hill towards our new home. Our eyes scanned the top of the hill for signs of armored vehicles, tanks, but we saw none. Why was it called Tank Hill? When we arrived at our new company, we found out. There were no army tanks on the hill. The tank was a large water reservoir tank which was used as a reference point by soldiers when they were out in the field on long marches. The trucks parked, and we unloaded our duffel bags and lined up in the street in front of the orderly and supply room buildings. A tall, muscular sergeant came out of the orderly room in a freshly pressed fatigue uniform with large Sergeant First Class stripes on his sleeves. He began to pace up and down the rows of recruits, stopping to look a few of us in the face. Then he stood in the center of our formation and introduced himself.
I am Sergeant Lin. I will be your senior training NCO while you are here at Delta Company. The Army wants me to make you all into good soldiers. God help us. You will learn that there are no individuals here, only team players. You are now Delta Team.
Sergeant Lin then called a group of his NCOs to the front and had our group broken down into platoons. Each platoon was given to one of the NCOs for them to take charge of our training. We were lucky in my platoon, for we got a nice mild-mannered non-commissioned officer, named Sergeant Ward. Sergeant Ward was a short, thin black man who spoke softly to us like an uncle. He was about 30 years old at the time and was married, living off base. He would soon be putting in long hours of day and night work, trying to mold us into fighting men. After the assignment, Sergeant Ward led us over to our barracks and got us settled in. Each man was assigned a bunk bed, wall locker, and foot locker. This building would be our home for the next 8 weeks. We spent that first night getting the barracks cleaned and polished, the first night of a regular routine that would be part of our training. Our training got underway immediately. We had daily physical training, running a few miles in our combat boots every morning at 0600 hours, swinging through ladder bars before going to breakfast chow, long days of learning about our M14 rifles, practicing on the bayonet range, and 10-mile marches out to the rifle ranges for marksmanship training. It seemed every moment of the day was filled with some kind of army training. In the evening, we would clean and secure our weapons and equipment and proceed to the mess hall for chow. We were always hungry after burning up so many calories throughout the day. The final meal of the day was especially important, as it was the last food we got until the morning. There were no snacks allowed in basic training. One evening, I was standing in front of the mess hall waiting for my turn to enter the building. While waiting, we had to stand at parade rest 4 feet apart from each other and read the general orders, which were printed on small signs attached to the side of the mess hall. As I studied my general orders, I got an unexpected visit from Sergeant Lin. He was walking along the line of recruits, weeding out anyone he felt was out of order, such as a man with unpolished boots or improper dress. Suddenly, he came up behind me and called me out of line. I came to attention and made an about-face. He leaned forward and put his nose close to my face.
Boy, when was the last time you had a haircut?
Sergeant, I had one 3 days ago.
You're a damn liar, recruit. Get your ass out of this line and get up to the barbershop now.
I quickly fell out of the chow line and ran up the hill to the barbershop. I got in line and waited my turn, all the while watching the wall clock as it ticked towards closing time for the chow hall. I got my hair cut and ran as fast as I could back to the mess hall as soon as they finished, but it was closed. I had missed chow and was one hungry recruit that night. I vowed then and there that I would never again get on Sergeant Lin's shit list. In his own cruel way, he had shown me the meaning of keeping myself straight. I took extra effort to always look my best from then on. I was lucky that I had not received Sergeant Lin's special treatment. When he saw a recruit messing up, he would make them do 25 push-ups, followed by a run through the ladder bars and a low crawl. Sergeant Lin had a knack for remembering names, and he would harass anyone he felt was a screw-up. I avoided him at all costs during my time on Tank Hill. As I began to adjust to my new Army life, I began to meet a few new friends to talk with. One of those new friends was a farm kid from Mississippi named Johnson. Johnson was a big boy, accustomed to heavy fieldwork on his grandmother's farm, and he often told me how religious his family was. He told me that I was the first white boy he ever was friendly with. When I asked him why, he told me about what life was like in the segregated South. It was all new to me. As I said before, when I was growing up, segregation wasn't really a thing I was exposed to. It wasn't long before our friendship was put to the test. A few weeks into our training, we were both on latrine cleanup duty.
As we washed out the sinks, two Negro city guys from another squad came into the latrine and called Johnson over to them. They spoke as though I wasn't even there, telling him that they did not want him getting friendly with me. One of them called him an Uncle Tom. I kept scrubbing the sink, trying to mind my own business. Finally, they left and Johnson returned to his duties with me. His eyes were filled with sadness. What were they talking about? I ain't supposed to be talking with you white boys.
Why not? What's the problem with talking?
You don't understand, do you? Down here we are not allowed to have white friends. Understand?
Yeah, sure, I guess.
But I really didn't understand what he meant. In my high school, white kids and black kids got along fairly well. Back then, I never had a problem with race relations. I just did not get this new setup. In the weeks to come, I got to see how all the Southern boys disliked my friendship with Johnson. Kelley, don't get too friendly with that black boy if you know what's good for you. You're looking for trouble. Now, I not only had a few black guys unhappy about me and Johnson, but the white guys were not happy either. It seemed our friendship was doomed. Once we understood the situation, Johnson and I began to keep our distance from each other. This was my first experience with Southern segregation, and I did not like it. Until my last week of basic training, I tried to keep a low profile. It was not easy. Occasionally, Johnson and I threw a friendly nod to each other. That was it. No talking anymore. In our last days in the platoon before graduation day, Johnson came over to me and shook my hand.
Soldier boy, you're a good guy. Don't let them change you.
That was the last I ever saw of Johnson. But as the months and years went by, I met others like him. I also met many men who, whether black or white, drew invisible lines in the sand that made it difficult for me and the Johnsons of the world to form relationships. The 60s were a time of unrest and turmoil in American society, and it found its way into the military. Despite the hardships and difficulties of basic training, I survived. All the forced marches with full field packs were over. All the long days firing on the ranges and running until you felt your lungs would burst were now behind us. The Army had made us into soldiers. I was now looking forward to my next assignment at the Army Aviation School.
Chapter 3. Helicopter School. Mike. After a long cross-country bus ride through the Deep South, we arrived at Fort Rucker, Alabama, home of the U.S. Army's Aviation School Training Center near the city of Dothan. I was excited about my new duty assignment. The lessons I learned in basic training had prepared me for this next experience in the land of Dixie. The bus pulled into the parking lot of the Enlisted Student Center, and we got off and formed up in a small platoon to wait for our NCO. We were processed into the school and given an old World War II barracks to live in. I was assigned to the first floor, and my new squad leader was a guy named Specialist Henry, who had re-enlisted in the Army to get a chance to attend the aviation school. He was a tall, lanky, good-natured fellow who took the time to show us young soldiers the ways of Army life. In the weeks to come, Henry would become our unofficial uncle. The school would be a big change for us. It was a more laid-back routine with no sergeants yelling in our faces. It was almost like a civilian job. We attended classes from 07:30 hours until 16:30 hours and had the evenings and weekends off duty. In between going to aviation classes, some of us had to pull kitchen police duty, KP, at the mess hall, usually on a weekend, where we spent all day washing dishes, pots and pans, and mopping floors. Our free time was spent drinking cheap beer at the snack bar or going to see a movie for 25 cents. Occasionally, they would give us a pass to go off base. The closest big town was Dothan, about a half-hour ride down the main highway. Shortly after our arrival, on a mild November afternoon, my new buddy Joe Aragona from Massapequa, New York, and I began to hitchhike our way to Dothan to explore life outside the Army post. The first leg of our trip was courtesy of an off-post sergeant who gave us a lift in his pickup truck from the main gate out to the highway. From there, we walked a few miles along the road with our thumbs up for a ride. Several cars sped right by us, and it looked as though we would not get a ride to Dothan.
Then an old beat-up 1952 Ford sedan pulled over to the side of the road, and the driver waved at us. We quickly ran to the car and looked inside to see an elderly black couple.
"Where are you boys going?"
"We're trying to get to Dothan." I pointed down the road in the direction we were headed.
"Well, I'm going through there if you want a ride. You can get in the back there."
Joe and I glanced at each other, briefly wondering if we should accept the ride. One look down the long highway was enough to make up our minds.
"Thank you."
We climbed into the back seat of the old car. The car rolled slowly along the right lane of the highway.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.